good morning. I'm over here. Change your line of sight. Shaking things up. We felt bad for the people on this side, so we kind of tried to help them out a little, you know. Good morning. Welcome to New Brunswick Church of Christ. We're glad you're here. A little rain. That's always good. So we're thankful for that. Things will get done in due time. Any visitors we'd like to recognize this morning out there, help me out. If not, like I said, we're glad you folks are all here. So several things to get through, so I'll try to keep moving and not forget anything. We will be doing May birthdays here at the end, so all you May birthdays, get ready. And don't forget, next Sunday is Mother's Day. Can't forget Mom, so it's only a week away. You better, if you haven't prepared, you better get there pretty fast. So, several things that we kind of need to mention. A couple things I'd like to share or read. One is from the family of David Duff, and it says, "Thank you for your kind expression of sympathy in his passing." So, share that with you. There's also a graduation announcement here for Catherine Clausen, and her open house is Sunday, May 21st, from 2 to 5. So be aware of that. And in that regard, it's kind of on the back of the bulletin. If there's any other graduates that would care to be, you know, recognized, share their information with the church office and so forth, please, please do so, whether that be high school, college, whatever the case may be. They'd like to be aware of that. And I believe Kathy has something she'd like to share with EBS.
Thank you. So I don't plan to do this every week, so don't stop coming just because you don't want to see me up here. So VBS, you know, is the week of Father's Day, Monday through Friday nights that week. We've got announcements as usual in the bulletin, but I have an additional two things to mention to you. I just handed out a half sheet flyer to some of you. There are more in the back. Our VBS mission this year will be different. We're supporting the Isaiah 117 house in Whitestown, which is a transitional place for children whom the court has taken from parents to be placed with foster families. And if they can't be placed immediately, they need a place to go. So the Isaiah 117 house is that place for three of our counties here. What we're going to do is give them our monetary offering for the week, but also we will take donations, because one of the things that they do for those children is give them, excuse me, give them clothing to wear. And so we'll be taking donations. Your flyer says pajamas, socks, T-shirts, and they need to be new. And so when you're going through the aisles at Walmart, you can grab some of those things, and we'll collect them. And we'll have a collection box out starting next week for those. But then we'll have the children bring that stuff all week. So you can put that on your list of things to do. And then, I have not said this to you yet, but I want you to know, if you're bringing children, that's bad. See, you know, I can't be the one to do it. If you're bringing children, or the people that you talk to who will bring children, they can go online and register them. That doesn't excite me in the least. I have to have a piece of paper and a pencil. But most of parents, and we've already got parents who've done that, go online to the church website. There's a link, and those kids can be registered just like that. So be sure and tell those folks whom you're inviting that we have online registration. And that's it for me today. Thank you.
I saw a bright light. It was Kathy. It wasn't her phone. It was Kathy. Thank you for sharing that with us. As I mentioned, I think it's time for May birthdays, so please come forward. Come Come on, there's got to be somebody out there. Really? You're going to leave me here holding the plate? Okay. We'll just say, we'll give mothers the honors since that'll be next week. There's Cheryl. There's a little age involved. Cheryl forgot it was her birthday. Let's all sing. Cora forgot too. So your memory can go at any age. Now we'll move on to prayer time. And I had a couple different things mentioned to me that I'll share. Obviously, we always want to keep the prayer list that we have in the bulletin at our ready. But Pat Clark is going to have a lumpectomy on Tuesday morning to kind of check things out for her. So be sure and be thinking of Pat and praying for her. There she is on Tuesday. And also, I was told that Mary Sedgwick passed away. That would be Kim Crouch's grandmother. So be thinking of their family as well at this time. Any others? Any other updates? Things we'd want to mention right now? Okay, well, let's go to the Lord in prayer then. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the power of prayer and what it means to each of us, and we pray, Lord, that we will rely on it heavily at any time of any day to be thankful for the things that you bless us with, but to lift up others, lift up concerns, lift our burdens and give them to you. We know the ones that were mentioned here this morning, and there are many others on the prayer list also that need your special strength, your special healing, your special caring and grace. So just help us, Lord, to be aware of those and to always be looking for others to lift up. Even VBS, we mentioned the power of prayer there to encourage and to help people to be involved and to just help it be successful, Lord, as each and every one of us tries each day to live for you and to lift you up wherever we are. We thank you again for this service, and we pray for our worship time, in the praise time, the communion time, and in Dwight sharing your word, that we'll all be blessed for having been here this morning. And as always, we lift up the shut-ins and the ones that are not here, that they will feel your spirit as well. All these things we pray in your name. Amen.
Good morning. What a joy it is to worship with you this morning. The past few weeks, we've been talking about compassion and what it means to be compassionate to one another. We've been reminded that love is patient and love is kind. Today we move on to love does not envy. The opposite of envy is contentment. And no matter what's going on in our lives, when we're following God, He gives us the peace and the contentment. Please stand as we sing.
In my wrestling and in my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea. In the silence, you won't let go. In the questions, your truth will hold. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. Oh, my lighthouse, I will trust the promise. You will carry me safe to shore. tomorrow brings. With each morning I'll rise and sing. My God's love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. Oh, my lighthouse, I will trust the promise. You will carry me safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore. For us, you're the brightest, you will lead us through the storms. Fire before us, you're the brightest, you will lead us through the storms. Fire before us, you're the brightest, you will lead us through the storms. Fire before us, you're the brightest, you will lead us through the storms. My lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. Oh, my lighthouse, I will trust the promise. You will carry me safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore. Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place. Though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering. Though there's pain in the offering, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. You give and take away, you give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name, Jesus. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
Blessed be his name. You may be seated. Paul says in Philippians 4:11-13, "For I have learned in whatever situation I am to be content. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, Whether living in plenty or in want, I can do all this through Him who gives me strength.
I come before you today, and there's just one thing that I want to say. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for all you've given to me, for all the blessings that I cannot see. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. With a grateful heart, with a song of praise, with an outstretched arm, I will bless your name. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. For all you've done in my life, you took my darkness and gave me your light. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You took my sin and my shame. You took my sickness and healed all my pain. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. With a grateful heart, with a song of praise, with an outstretched arm, I will bless your name. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Bless the Lord, my soul, and do not forget any of his benefits, who pardons all your guilt, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with favor and compassion.
When peace like a river attends,
Satan should buffet
Our meditation this morning is titled, Again. Here we go again. It's time for communion. Again. Once more with feeling. Right, you think. This feels like deja vu. Like using shampoo. Wash, rinse, repeat. Why can't this be once and done? After all, that's what Christ did. He died on the cross once. He wiped out our sins once, and now we are redeemed and headed toward heaven. Yes, what Christ did, he did once. There's no need for Jesus to repeat his death and resurrection. But we have a desperate need to hold in our hearts and minds the reality, the power, the amazement of what he accomplished. To do this well requires us to become like little children. Among children, again is a favorite word. Do it again, Daddy. Take me there again, Mommy. Children can seem like stuck, broken records. They feel the joy of a moment, experience the wonder of life with new eyes, and they want to go again and again and again until they're exhausted. Yet even then, as they're nodding off to sleep, they'll mumble, again. Repeating something again and again plants the memory deep and multiplies the joy. The same can be true for us, grown-up, serious adults. Repetition is sacred. God's mercies renew every morning, and we need them every morning and afternoon and evening. Thank God for the grace of again. So here we are, communion, again. Washing, rinsing, repeating, the breaking of bread and the drinking of the juice. Remembering the reality behind these symbols, the wonder-working power of the blood shed for us. His body nailed to the cross for us. In the Old Testament, the children of Israel offered their sacrifices again and again. Burnt offerings, grain offerings, peace offerings, sin offerings, trespass offerings. Through these offerings, they worshiped the Most High God, atoned for sins, and acted out their obedience. With each offering, the fire and the smoke reminded them of who he was and their relationship with him. Now we cry out again. Again, Lord, remember us in our neediness, in our sorrows, in our joys. Again, Lord, let us call all you have done for us, all you are to us, all you provide for us, all you have created us to be. In gladness, again, we bow our hearts and receive these symbols of holiness and redemption. Let's pray. Thank you, dear Lord, for what you do for us again and again, every day. We pray that you will continue to guide us and lead us and strengthen us to follow you more closely, but to know that you're always there with us. And especially now as we remember what Christ did for us as we meet around your table. And as these emblems remind us of his broken body and shed blood. And being the humans that we are, Lord, we do need to be reminded. We tend to forget. So please stay with us, guide us, strengthen us, and help us to do that. And to feel your presence and to look inside our hearts this morning, Lord, to draw closer to you and to live better and stronger for you each and every day. Thank you again for this special time in our service, and help us to put away all the other thoughts that might be trying to crowd in and focus on you. In your name we pray. Amen.
If you have your Bibles, and I hope that you do, find Mark chapter 10. We'll get there in just a few minutes. There was a local preachers' meeting where the ministers from different denominations came together to talk about and do things for the community. The Baptist preacher showed up a little bit early, at the Methodist church. And as he showed up, the Methodist preacher was outside. It was one of those old-fashioned signboards that you had to take letters off and then put letters back on, that kind of thing. And when he showed up, the Methodist preacher was changing the signboard. And the sign said, "God saved the best for last. You shall not covet." And the Baptist preacher walked over to the guy and he says, "Man, I really like your sign. I wish we had one of those." Okay. Somebody will explain that to you later on this afternoon. It was funny. Envy is one of those things that just doesn't work well for any of us. It doesn't look good on any of us. Google says it's a feeling of discontentment or resentful longing for something someone else has. It could be possessions or qualities or luck. Webster says envy is the painful or resentful awareness of an advantage enjoyed by someone else. And there's a big difference. I was talking with somebody last week, and I was talking about this message, and they said, "Yeah, jealousy and envy, they just don't look good." And I said, "Well, I think that jealousy and envy are different. Jealousy is when we have something and we want to protect it. We're jealous of anybody who might want that, but we're envious of what someone else has, and we want to possess it. That's where the problem comes in. You can be jealous of your wife and yet envious of the wife of another, for example. There are two different situations. Envy is such a destructive emotion. It was labeled one of the seven deadly sins by the early church fathers. The 10th of the commandments, the last one that was referenced, "You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or his manservant or maidservant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor." So over the last couple of weeks, we've been talking about this understanding of walking the good walk. We want to be more like Jesus. We want to live more like Jesus. We want people to see Jesus living in us. And there are attributes that are listed here in 1 Corinthians 13. And we started out, as was already mentioned, by looking at compassion, the perfect love, the perfect type of love that Jesus had. And then he lists some attributes. In verse 4, Paul says, "Love is patient." We got that one all down pat, right? After a couple weeks ago. Now, every one of you have become more patient since then, right? Yeah, I don't believe you either. Love is patient. Love is kind, and we're still working on both of those. But then he follows it up, and he says, "Love does not envy." So in order to really love people, we cannot allow ourselves to be resentful of what others have that we might wish we had. We need to develop the opposite attitude. That is the attitude of contentment, being content with what God has blessed us with. So let's look at this from a very simple standpoint. The very first thing there in your notes is the problem. There is a problem when we have envy in our heart. Most all of us at one time or another have had a problem with envy. I don't know what it is that makes you envious, but I know what is common. A lot of times, one of the most common things are material possessions. When somebody has a little bit more money, or maybe they have a nicer home or a nicer vehicle, or they go on exotic vacations, or they're wearing the latest fashions or the most expensive jewelry, and you battle resentment because you would like to have those same type of things. You're not happy with what you have. You're not able to rejoice with them, but you struggle with envy inside. James says, "Where you have envy and selfish ambition, there you find disorder and every evil practice." And so that's a problem. Some of us are envious of personal relationships. We become envious when someone else's wife is more beautiful or someone else's husband is more romantic. I remember it was 30-something years ago. I had one of those mornings where things were really clicking, and I had used several humorous illustrations, and after the service, a lady walked up to Joe, and she said, "Your husband is so creative. He is so funny. I bet it is just a joy living with somebody like that, day after day after day." And she said, "Yeah, it's just a ton of fun." You may get envious when somebody else's child is more talented or more compliant, or your child is, their child is above average and your child is not. You may be envious of a coworker's friendship with a boss. Those are areas that we struggle with. Material possessions, personal relationships, or influential opportunities. Most of us remember the story of David and Goliath. David became a very popular general in King Saul's army after having killed Goliath, the giant that had been rebuking Jehovah God. And after one of David's great military victories, there was a big parade in his honor, and everybody was shouting out that Saul had killed his thousands, but David had killed his 10,000s. And Saul became very envious of David's popularity, and he began plotting to find the way to take David down. Think about it. It's tough to see someone else promoted. It's tough when you're the one sitting the bench. There was a great composer many years ago. Some of you may remember the name Leonard Bernstein. He was the famous symphony conductor who worked with the Philadelphia Philharmonic. And he was asked one time, "What is the toughest instrument to play in the orchestra?" And his response was on target. He said, "Second fiddle." Because nobody wants to sit the bench. Everybody wants the lead. Everyone wants to be the star. It's tough when your friend gets the recognition and you go unnoticed. I remember a lady saying in a Weight Watchers meeting, it came back to me later on, she said in the meeting, "Lord, if you can't make me thin, help my friends look fat." Sometimes it's difficult to see others succeed. Sometimes it's a problem if people have the positions of influence that you want, and you become envious of those situations. The religious leaders of Jesus' day couldn't stand it that the crowds were flocking to this talented, dynamic rabbi from Nazareth. So they scrutinized his every word. They criticized his every action. They plotted until eventually they presented him to Pilate to be crucified. And when Pilate interviewed Jesus and put him under interrogation, he came back to the Jewish leaders. He says, "I find no fault in this man." But he realized that he had been handed over because they were envious of him. And you know what? Even if you are a follower, you still struggle with envy. It's difficult not to be envious of somebody who works in the same lane as you do. I'm not envious of my wife and her ability to sing, or Nancy and her ability to lead, or Martha and her ability to play, because those aren't areas of my giftedness. But when I see someone else teach with so much ease, individuals who are able to stand up and present something creative in a very simple way, and so simplistic to remember, and it's so much enjoyment in it, I become a little bit envious of those individuals. I've enjoyed the month of May stuff on TV, and I enjoyed the Derby yesterday, but I never dreamed of being a race car driver, or never dreamed of being a jockey. But if I see somebody my age who plays golf better, there are times that I'm a little bit envious. When I was in Tennessee, I played in a seniors league, and I was meeting men from all over the area. And some had been retired executives and guys who had made lots and lots of money. And I would show up to play golf with these guys, and they would pull out one club that was the equivalent of my house payment. And I became a little bit envious until I saw it really didn't help their game any, and then it was okay. What makes you envious? What makes you envious reveals a great deal about your personal goals. It tells us what your ambitions are. And envy has horrible consequences. It can ruin our happiness. I was talking with somebody this morning, and something triggered, and it reminded me of the story of Snow White. You never knew you were going to get such theology this morning as Snow White, did you? You remember Snow White? The story is about the wicked queen who went to the mirror every day, and what did she say? This is participation time. What did she say? Exactly. Mirror, mirror on the wall, who's the fairest of them all? And she was elated when every single time the mirror said, "Oh, queen, you're the one. You're number one. You're the fairest of all within the land." But then there was this one day that she comes to the mirror and says it again. And then the queen hears this reply. "You've been upstaged by a more beautiful person. Her name is Snow White." And she went ballistic. You remember that? She couldn't believe that there was somebody better than her. Now, it wasn't that she instantly became ugly. She did not have warts all over her face. It was just the fact that she couldn't stand being number two. And immediately the wicked queen was so overcome that she it ruined all of her happiness and ruined her contentment. Proverbs says, "A heart at peace gives life to the body, but envy rots the bones." Envy also ruins our personality. It's not fun being around someone who's always wanting what someone else has. It's not fun being around somebody who's never happy with what they have, but they're always dreaming of what somebody else has. Do you remember the story in 1 Kings 21? Okay, you probably need more information than that, right? Ahab is one of the guys, and Jezebel is the other. You remember them? And there was this lonely guy by the name of Naboth. Now, Ahab had it all going as the king. He had everything that you could dream of. He was powerful, he was wealthy, but there was this one little piece of ground, not much bigger than a postage stamp, that he could not possess. And it belonged to a guy by the name of Naboth, who would not sell it under any circumstances. And in 1 Kings 21, it says, "So Ahab went home, sullen and angry, because Naboth the Jezreelite had said, 'I will not give you the inheritance of my fathers.' He lay on his bed sulking and refused to eat." He is the king of the kingdom. And he's acting like a little child. He has great wealth. He has great power. And he's acting like some unhappy, ungrateful little brat. And that leads to the last idea. It ruins relationships. Cain and Abel is the first story in the Bible that talks about how detrimental envy can be. Cain became envious of Abel's good standing with God, and so he murdered his own brother. Now, when you're envious of somebody, you're not going to commit murder. I'm 95% sure of that. But you may become resentful and critical, and there may be a coolness in a relationship that you once enjoyed. And sometimes it happens gradually. You try to pretend things aren't any different because they have achieved things that you wish you had achieved. But there's such a thing of a difficult distance that just kind of creeps in there in relationships. It can destroy everything. In 1 Peter chapter 2, the Apostle Peter writes, "Rid yourselves of all malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and slander of every good kind." He says, "Like newborn babies, crave pure spiritual milk so that by it you may grow up." That's what we're talking about. There are certain things we have to put away in order to grow up and walk the good walk and be more like Jesus. So now look at your Bible. In Mark chapter 10, here's an illustration of envy in the life and ministry of Jesus. There are two disciples, James and John. They come to Jesus with a special request. Jump down to about verse 37. Verse 37 says this: "Let one of us sit at your right hand and the other at your left in your glory." Now, these two brothers had this preconceived notion that the Lord's kingdom was going to be coming at a very soon moment. And they wanted to be able to be top dog along with Jesus. They pictured him reigning on a powerful throne. They had no idea that there was going to be a cruel crucifixion and a death. They heard Jesus talking about the coming kingdom. They thought it was near. They wanted to get their applications in. For some reason, they felt they deserved special recognition, and they wanted to be on the left and the right hand of Jesus. They felt like the sacrifices they made by leaving their home and following him afforded them that opportunity. And they were probably encouraged by the fact, if you really want to get down to it, that most every time Jesus would take a small group aside, it was always Peter, James, and John. So they would felt that they just were owed that opportunity. As a matter of fact, Matthew goes a little bit further. Matthew says in Matthew 20 that the two brothers were spurred on by their mother. Now, I'm not going to say anything detrimental about moms today because next week is Mother's Day, but I think most of us can understand how moms can be. They think their boys are the best and that Jesus ought to promote them automatically because they're wonderful. But the reaction of the other disciples was outrage. Look at verse 41. When the 10 heard about this, they became indignant with James and John. They did not appreciate what these two dudes were doing because they got the upper hand on them. They promoted themselves, and they were upset because they didn't think about it. They didn't go ahead and go to Jesus first. They were envious because James and John had requested something that evidently they would like to have had as well. When you have this unconcealed ambition combined with uncontrolled envy, you're going to have trouble. Remember what I said just a few moments ago from the book of James? When you have envy and selfish ambition, you have disorder and every kind of evil practice. Look at verse 38. "You don't know what you're asking for," Jesus said. "Can you drink the cup I drink or be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with?" And they answered right away, "Sure, we can." Jesus says, "You have no idea of what it is that I'm going to experience in the next few months." So often, we look at other people's positions of influence or other people's notoriety, or we look at what they've achieved, and we become envious, and we have no idea the pressures that they're under, the things that they had to go through to get there, the things that they had to do. We look at other people and say, "I wish I had that kind of money," or "I wish I had that kind of power," or "I wish I had that kind of say in my vocation." We have no idea. Most people are envious of doctors and their hours, but they have no idea to take time to think about all the work they put in to get where they are. Or a pro athlete and the practices and the sacrifices. James and John were given prominent positions in the kingdom, but James was beheaded, and John was kicked out of the country. Jump over to verse 39, finish that verse up. He says, "You will drink the cup I drink and be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with, but to sit at my right or my left is not for me to grant. Those places belong to those for whom they've been prepared." Jesus didn't say there aren't going to be special places of leadership. He just says it's not up to me to decide that. Over the last few weeks, pre-draft time, there's been all this conversation about who the Colts were going to draft, which quarterback they were going to go after, and all the reasons why they ought to draft this one or this one or this one. And then when they drafted somebody else that nobody expected, then there's all this other controversy. You draft the person you feel has the best ability to do the job that you have set before them. And God determines who receives those positions within the church or within the kingdom. And they belong to those from whom God has prepared by experience and talent and training. Jesus didn't even say it was wrong to desire those positions. After all, in 1 Timothy chapter 3, the Bible says, if you desire to be an overseer, you desire a good work. You need to have a healthy balance between ambition and contentment. To remain just status quo is not necessarily contentment. Sometimes it's just laziness. Sometimes it's just indifference. Do you remember the parable of the talents in Matthew chapter 25? Jesus told this parable about a landowner who gave out talents. He gave to one five, and he gave to another with two, and to another one one. And the one that he had given five and two, they went out and they increased by doubling what they had. But there was one who did nothing. And Jesus referred to him as wicked and lazy. He was not ambitious enough to improve. Now, I want to make sure you get this next thought. It's in your notes, so there's going to be a slide for it. But here's what I want you to get. Contentment is being satisfied with God's assignment in your life. It's doing your very best to fulfill your role without comparing yourself to anybody else. Find out what God has gifted you to do and do it to the best of your ability for His glory, not for yours. You see, sometimes we forget we're one family working together for one purpose, one vision, not so people will come around and pat us on the back, but so that God receives the glory as people are added to the kingdom. We need to be content with what we have, but not with who we are. We should always be striving to be more like Jesus, always be striving to have a better understanding and a better knowledge of what it is that He would have us to do. Verse 42 says, Jesus called the disciples together and said, you know that those who are regarded as rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them, but not so with you. Look what He says. Whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant. You see, when we accept Christ as Lord, we're to take on a different mindset. We're to develop a different set of priorities. That's what this series is all about, reconfiguring our priorities, our values, our understanding, to be more like Jesus and less like the world. The world's concerned about status. We should be concerned about serving. The world's comparing and competing with each other. We need to understand that God has created us differently and use what He has given us. The world's dominated by envy and jealousy. We need to rejoice with what others have, when others succeed. God makes us different. We need to quit comparing and learn to rejoice over the gifts God has bestowed on us and work hard to do the right thing. But too many times we become envious. So here's how we can eliminate it. Number one, completely surrender your life to Jesus. I love these words by Paul to a young guy named Titus, and I think it is fitting for each of us. He said, at one time, we too were foolish and disobedient and deceived and enslaved by all kinds of passions and pleasures. And I think most of us can understand that. I'm so glad that I did not grow up in the era of social media. I was sitting up here this morning talking with a few people, admitting some of my failings as a high schooler, but very few of you know that, and the people I told it to this morning, but never repeat it. We lived in malice and envy, being hated and hating one another, but when the kindness and love of God, our Savior, appeared, He saved us, not because of righteous things we had done, because of his mercy. He saved us through the washing and rebirth and renewal of the Holy Spirit. We're different. And we ought to live different lives. When we are saved by Christ, his will becomes more important than our ego. I'm your servant, Lord, and your will be done. That's what Mary said, and it has been the vision and purpose of every follower there since. When Jesus cleanses us from sin, he creates a new heart. Doesn't mean that we're not tempted. It just means that we have the ability to work through it. It's a daily struggle. It's a daily struggle for me. I know it's a daily struggle for you. But we can't continue playing the game of being one person on Sunday and somebody different Monday through Saturday. When you become a Christian, as you grow as a Christian, you've got to be mature enough to live a completely surrendered life. New set of priorities. New set of ambitions. The second thing is stop and count your blessings. I learned that a long, long time ago. My grandfather's favorite song was the song that we used to sing regularly at my home church. Count your blessings. Name them one by one. And it will surprise you what the Lord has done. I doubt that we really take time to count our blessings. Maybe one of the few times we do is when we see those who are less fortunate. A preacher friend of mine had posted in his Facebook a while back of an elderly woman in his congregation confined to a wheelchair whose mind is also slipping. And she gets her meaning every day, he wrote, by sitting at her window and counting the number of cars that go by. And when he would go by to visit, each day, each time he would come, she would give a different number, but she would say something like, you know, 200 cars drove by here today. Can you count your blessings that you can get up and go? That you're still lucid and able to communicate? That you have people who care about you? Count your blessings. What about those of us who have children that have been blessed in a tremendous way? We need to be reminded that there are other people out there who are hurting. If your child has been a blessing to you, just rejoice of that. What if you were to wake up tomorrow with only the things you thanked God for yesterday? We need to learn to do a better job in counting our blessings. Nancy referred to the scripture earlier. I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need. I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation. I can do everything through him who gives me strength. The third thing is develop maturity to work and wait. I've done a lot of premarital counseling over the years. And I've seen a gradual change over the last 20. Young people getting married over the last 20 years, they want to start out with the things that their mom and dads had worked 20 or 30 years to accumulate. Freud said the ability to postpone gratification is a mark of maturity. And our problem today is our children start out being given everything while they're young. I saw this statement the other day, and then when I went back to find it on Facebook, I couldn't find it. But it was something like this. We need to learn to take time to frustrate our children. And then it said, with the word no. I told my daughter when we were there a couple weeks ago, and our grandson had just received another toy, and for no reason whatsoever. I said, you're who I'm going to be talking to next week. She loves her son. Our son-in-law loves his son. But they have spoiled him without end. It is said that the average adult is able to do about 15% of what they have on their bucket list. And if the couple is wealthy, maybe 25%. So if you were to make your list of things that you would like to do before you die, you could do about 15% of them, maybe 20. But if you're a typical American parent, typical, it said, you give your child 75% of the things they want in a year's time. Is it any wonder that our children are growing up with this preconceived notion that there ought to be things just given to them for no reason whatsoever? It's time that we frustrate them sometimes with the word no, because they can't have everything when they become an adult. Success is a journey. It's not a destination. It should be enjoyed the whole trip, not just endured until the final end. The last thing is this. Treat that person, act lovingly toward the ones we envy. That's tough. But the scripture tells us to rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. And I've said this many times over the years. I don't know how many times I've said it here already, but I honestly believe that it's easier for us to weep with those who weep than it is to rejoice with those who rejoice. Because many times the people that we are supposed to rejoice with, they're rejoicing over things we would like to have. And that's when envy just kind of creeps in our life a little ways. I don't know if you've ever heard the name Zig Ziglar or not, but I heard him tell this story a long, long time ago when his children were young, and I was just starting to play golf, and one of my children was interested in playing, and his story has stuck with me ever since. Ziglar was a motivational speaker. He was a great author. He wrote books like See You at the Top or Born to Win or Embrace the Struggle, really good stuff. And he loved the game of golf, but as his children were growing up, he gave it up for a time because he wanted to spend more time with his family, and with his heavy schedule, he just didn't have the time. But then when his son turned 12, he thought he would get him interested in golf, and so he had a set of clubs made for him and a set of clubs made for his wife, and he thought the three of them would be great going out and playing golf together. Well, the son played two or three times with his dad, and he said, "Dad, I really enjoy being out here hanging out with you, but golf's not my thing." And then after a while, his wife said, "You know, I'm just not really enjoying it either, but you just go ahead and play." But he felt guilty every time he would go, and so he just did it sporadically. But then when his son was about 15 or 16, he decided that he wanted to give it a try again. And they were going somewhere together, and his son said, "Dad, I think I want to start playing golf again. Do you suppose we can go hit some balls someday?" And Zig said, "I have my clubs in the trunk. Let's go do it right now." And so they did, and his son was just hitting the ball straight and pure, and he was like, "This is going to be so much fun." So they went to the driving range a few more times, and then he went out one day to play. And it was an exciting moment, the two of them teeing it up together. On the second hole, I don't know how much you know about golf, but on the second hole, the son hit a spectacular shot. He made it to the green on the second shot and had a chance for a birdie, which is a significant thing. And it was only about 20 feet putt, and Ziglar said he was more excited than his son. And he helped him read the putt. He helped him. He got down on all fours to look for the grain and how it was going to break and what the speed ought to be and all these different things, because he wanted his son to know the joy of making a big putt. And when he putted the ball, it went in. He said his son must have jumped 3 or 4 feet in the air. And Ziglar said, "But he came down a full second before I did." And then Ziglar said this, which is what caught my attention. He said, "Then I realized I had a putt for birdie, and my putt was closer than his. And initially I thought, I'm not going to make it, because I want him to experience the joy of having a birdie. And then he said, then I thought, if I miss it on purpose, and my son says, Dad, did you give it your best? I can't lie to him. And so Ziegler lined up the putt and putted the ball, and it went straight in the hole. And the son began clapping and cheering for his dad. As they walked off the green to get in the cart, Ziegler looked at his son. He says, I want to ask you a question, and I want you to be honest. He said, were you hoping that I would make that putt? And his son looked at him and said, Dad, I always root for you. Do you always root for others? Do you always root for others to succeed? For others to do well? For others to improve? For others to get the attaboys? If you're not, then maybe you're still struggling a little bit with envy. And it's something you really need to work on, to learn to be content. Because envy is an ugly color for any of us to wear. And Jesus wants us to be more like him, who was content to go to the cross for people like you and me. Let's pray. Father, sometimes we just forget who we're supposed to be. We get so caught up in being more like our neighbors or being more like our friends or following in the footsteps of others instead of walking the good walk with your son. Or just make us more like Jesus and less like the world. Help us to root on those around us. Like the Hebrew writer said, to be there to cheer on the saints. We pray that if there's someone here today who has a decision to make, that you'll work within their hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand together. The ladies are going to lead us in a song of invitation. And if you have a public decision to make, we want to offer you that opportunity.
This is my desire, to honor you, Lord, with all my heart I worship you. All I have within me I give.
Be sure and count our blessings this week. Be thankful for what we do have and don't worry about what we don't. let's close. Thank you, Lord, for all the blessings that we do have. Help us to take the time to count them on occasion, to remember all that you do for us, and to be thankful and joyful in that. We pray for everyone as they leave this service this morning, Lord, that they will be safe, and that again, we'll go do our job, Lord, and that is to shine your light wherever we go. Thank you for Jesus and for this church, this congregation, everyone here that's this morning, and all those that are not, and we know that they were missed. In your name we pray. Amen.
I just came to praise the Lord. I just came to praise the Lord. I just came to praise His holy name. I just came to praise the Lord. I just came to thank the Lord. I just came to thank the Lord. I just came to praise His holy name. I just came to thank the Lord. I just came to thank the Lord.
Have a blessed week.